In this video, we're tackling a pretty heavy concept question on the center of mass reference frame. And the main point here isn't to solve a collision problem. The point is to really deepen your understanding of the properties of the center of mass frame. So we're using this theorem of mechanics that says the net momentum of a system is equal to the total mass of the system multiplied by the center of mass velocity. And I'll post a link to where that was first derived. This means we can get the center of mass velocity by computing the net momentum of the system. And this allows us to use our relative velocity formulas to transform all the velocities into the center of mass frame. Well, the center of mass velocity is zero if we switch into the center of mass reference frame. And that means the net momentum should be zero in the center of mass frame as well. And this is the key property that makes the center of mass frame useful. So in this problem, we're going to test this property out by explicitly transforming the velocities of three particles from the lab frame into the center of mass frame. And then we can numerically verify that the sum of the momenta is actually zero in the center of mass frame. So in part A, we're asked to compute the net momentum components of the particles in the lab frame. So we want to get Px, and we're going to use the usual convention that leftward means negative, rightward means positive, and we just start adding together the x components of the momenta. So if we look at particle number one over here, we're given the velocity, an angle with respect to the horizontal, and a mass. And we want to take that mass, that's 0.1 kilograms, just converting the units, and then multiply by the x component of the velocity. Well, since that points to the left, we need a minus sign. So I'm going to put a minus sign in there and say 5.8 meters per second. Times the cosine of 65. Then we go to particle two. Again, we need to convert the mass units to kilograms, so that's 0.150. And I have a rightward velocity component here of 4.2 cosine 40. Finally, particle three, the mass is 0.120 there. Again, it's a rightward pointing component, so it counts as positive, and that's 6.1 cosine of 25. And I'm going to keep four digits throughout my calculations here. This gives me approximately 0.9009 kilogram meters per second. Now we do the y component. And particle one has an upward y component of its velocity of 5.8 sine of 65. The second particle, again with a mass of 0.150, has an upward y component for its velocity of 4.2 sine of 40. And our third particle, with a mass of 0.120, has a downward y component, so that takes a minus sign, and that's given by 6.1 sine of 25. And again, keeping four digits, I get 0.6213 kilogram meters per second. So those are the net momentum components, and then in part B, we're asked to compute the center of mass velocity components for the system. So we have this theorem of mechanics that says the net momentum is the total mass times the center of mass velocity. Like any vector equation, it can be broken into components, and I can say that Pnet in the x direction, that's what we computed in our first line under part A, is equal to the total mass times the x component of the center of mass velocity, and similar for the y component. This means that the x component of the center of mass velocity is given by 1 over the total mass, that's what the capital M stands for, multiplied by the x component of the net momentum. So we take 1 over the total mass, and I'm just converting to kilograms again as I go, and that's 0.1 plus 0.150 plus 0.120 multiplied by that net x component of the momentum, which was 0.9009. And we arrive at an x component for the center of mass velocity of positive 2.435 meters per second. So the center of mass is tracking along to the right at 2.435 meters per second, in the lab reference frame. We do a similar calculation for the y component of the center of mass velocity. That's 1 over the total mass times the y component of the net momentum. And that y component of the momentum was 0.6213 kilogram meters per second. And we find that the y component of the center of mass velocity is positive 1.679. So the center of mass is tracking farther and farther to the right at 2.435 meters per second and also going upwards at a speed of 1.679 meters per second. Now it's useful to visualize this motion of the center of mass of the system. So there's the components of our center of mass velocity, 2.435 to the right, 1.679 meters per second upward, and the vector sum of those is our center of mass velocity vector. And we're going to have to refer back to these components multiple times, so it's just nice to have that picture. So now in part C of the problem, we want to convert all three of our velocities to the center of mass reference frame. And we need a reminder of how we go about converting velocities into a new frame of reference. I'll post a link to where this was first derived, but there's a beautiful notation for making these transformations. So we can say the velocity of an object with respect to the center of mass frame is equal to the velocity with respect to the lab frame plus the velocity of the lab frame with respect to the center of mass. This notation is really useful as a mnemonic device because we sort of think of it as a cancellation happening in order to keep track of what order things have to be done in. So the velocity of an object with respect to the lab, that's what we're being given for all these velocities in the initial setup of the problem. The velocity of the lab with respect to the center of mass, this is a little bit tricky because what we found down here for the center of mass velocity, that's the velocity of the center of mass with respect to the lab, not the velocity of the lab with respect to the center of mass. So our center of mass is moving up and to the right with respect to the lab, and this means the lab is moving down and to the left with respect to the center of mass. In other words, the velocity of the lab with respect to the center of mass is the negative of the velocity of the center of mass with respect to the lab. So we have to make that replacement. And now we can use those center of mass velocity components that we computed on the last slide. So for all three of these particles, we need to take the velocity of the particle with respect to the lab and subtract the velocity of the center of mass with respect to the lab. And we're doing this component-wise. So we have actually six calculations that have to be done. And we'll start with the velocity of particle 1 with respect to the center of mass, x component. That's the velocity of particle 1 with respect to the lab, x component, minus the velocity of the center of mass with respect to the lab, x component. So the velocity of particle 1 with respect to the lab, x component, is given by 5.8 cosine of 65, but it also carries a minus sign. So negative 5.8 cosine 65. And then we subtract the center of mass velocity x component, which is 2.435 meters per second. And when we smash these together, we get negative 4.886 meters per second. In other words, now that we're running to the right along with the center of mass, it makes the leftward velocity of particle 1 look bigger. We do the same thing for the y component. And the y component of the velocity in the lab frame is 5.8 sine of 65. And then we subtract the y component of the center of mass velocity, which was 1.679. And this gives us a y velocity component of 3.578 meters per second in the center of mass frame. Now we do the same for particle 2. And when we get the velocity of particle 2 with respect to the lab x component, that's 4.2 cosine 40 degrees. That's moving to the right, so it comes with a plus sign. And then we subtract the x component of the center of mass velocity, which was 2.435, and this gives us 0.7824 meters per second. Y component in the center of mass frame for particle 2. We take the y component in the lab and subtract the y component of the center of mass velocity. And the y component of the velocity in the lab frame for particle 2 was 4.2 sine of 40. And we subtract from that the y component of the center of mass velocity, which was 1.679. And when we run the numbers on this, we get 1.021 meters per second in the center of mass frame. Finally, we do particle 3. So the x component of the velocity of particle 3 in the center of mass frame is given by the x component in the lab minus the x component of the center of mass velocity. And so the x component of the velocity in the lab is 6.1 cosine of 25. And then we're going to subtract 2.435. And this gives us 3.093 meters per second. Okay, and again, that means that this particle number 3 is moving to the right with respect to the location of the center of mass of this system at 3.093 meters per second. Finally, we do the y component. And the y component of the velocity of particle 3, remember that takes a negative sign. It's going to be negative 6.1 sine of 25. And then we subtract the y component of the center of mass velocity, 1.679. And this gives us negative 4.257 meters per second with respect to the center of mass. So it's moving down with respect to the center of mass at 4.257 meters per second. All right, so all of our velocities have now been transformed into the center of mass reference frame. We have particle 1's components there, particle 2's, and particle 3's components there. Now we can compute the momentum in the center of mass frame. And again, according to our wonderful theorem of mechanics, the net momentum should vanish in the center of mass frame. So we want to compute the x component of the momentum measured in the center of mass frame. And for particle 1, we had a mass of 0.1 kilograms and an x coordinate of the velocity in the center of mass frame of negative 4.886 meters per second. Particle 2, with a mass of 0.150, had an x component of its velocity of 0.7824 in the center of mass frame. And particle 3, with a mass of 0.120, had a velocity of 3.093 in the center of mass frame. Now, when we run the numbers on this, we get 0.00008. And the reason it's not exactly zero is because we've been rounding throughout the whole calculation. So the point is that this is approximately equal to zero, and that one checks out. Now we look at the y component of the momentum measured in the center of mass frame. Again, back to particle 1 with a mass of 0.1 kilograms. And this particle had a y velocity component of 3.578 in the center of mass frame. Particle 2 with a mass of 0.150 kilograms had a y component of velocity of 1.021 in the center of mass frame. And finally, particle 3 with a mass of 0.120, that had a velocity of negative 4.257 meters per second with respect to the center of mass. When we run the numbers on this, we get about 0.0001, which again is the result of a little bit of rounding error. The point is that it's approximately equal to zero. So just a final reminder, the point of all of this is to just verify this theorem of mechanics that P net is equal to the total mass times the center of mass velocity. This allowed us to find the center of mass velocity just by using 1 over the total mass times the net momentum, and we did that component wise. This allowed us to transform to the center of mass reference frame. And then we said, well, in the center of mass reference frame, the net momentum should be zero since the velocity of the center of mass is zero in that frame. And that zero is extremely convenient for solving collisions in the center of mass reference frame. But that's a topic for another video, and I'll post a link to one of those videos on the end screen. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab. And best of luck on your math and physics journey.